House Father, MP for Mount Royal, David Birnbaum, MNA for Darcy McGee, Councillor Dita Burke, who I believe is also in the audience, Edmond Elbaz, President of the Spanish and Portuguese Synagogue, and our guest speaker tonight is James Archibald, past President of the Spanish and Portuguese Synagogue. I also want to give a very special thanks to Cindy Katz for helping to coordinate this event and for all her collaboration. It was really a pleasure to work with you, Cindy. I don't know where you are, but there you are. Thank you so much. Give her a big hand. So after the lecture, I would like to invite you all into the library to view the exhibit, which documents the history of the synagogue. Refreshments will be in the multipurpose room, which is just off the children's library, so I'm inviting you all to that as well. And now please extend a very warm welcome to the mayor of Côte Saint-Luc, Mitchell Brownstein. Thank you.
Thank you, Janine. It's great being here with Anthony. David, thank you for coming. We have all levels of government here. How exciting, celebrating a milestone, 250 years with the Jewish community. And I have a special relationship personally with the Spanish and Portuguese synagogue. My grandparents lived on Isabella and Lemieux. They moved there, I think, Mom, in 1949. And from 1949 until about 11, 12 years ago, my grandfather would attend that synagogue and my grandmother 4 years prior. And it was a place that we would go. And Rabbi Joseph was the rabbi when I was a kid. And it was a really special place to go. I would go for the lower holidays. I always said, you know, come Mitchell, be with us on Simchas Torah and Sukkot. So it was really a very special place for me all those years. The Spanish and Portuguese Synagogue, as we know, it was founded in 1768. And the city of Côte Saint-Luc is very proud to be a part of this celebration. We passed a resolution. I'm going to read that resolution, or that motion. And it says as follows. Whereas the Spanish and Portuguese Synagogue of Montreal is the oldest Jewish congregation in Canada dating back to 1768, whereas this year the congregation is celebrating their 250th anniversary, whereas its original founders of Sephardic descent came from England, the history of the synagogue, first known as Shearith, Israel, reflects the various waves of migration that constitute Jewish Montreal. Whereas today the synagogue has evolved into one of the most diverse congregations on the island of Montreal, regrouping Jews of Ashkenazi and Sephardic descent with origins from Spain and Portugal and Great Britain, Iran, Iraq, Lebanon, Egypt, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, as well as those with origins in Northern, Western, and Eastern Europe. Whereas the congregation of 800 families practicing different traditions under the same roof is a microcosm of Canadian multiculturalism and harmony and diversity, and is a symbol of inclusion and positive intercommunity relations. Whereas the Spanish and Portuguese synagogue has contributed to the well-being of the Montreal Jewish community through the creation of the Baron de Hirsch Institute, now OMETS, which has provided social services to the community since 1890. Whereas many residents of Côte Saint-Luc have historical ties to the synagogue, including me. Whereas the city of Côte Saint-Luc would like to recognize the synagogue's proud history and join in celebrating the milestone. And this was moved by Councillor Dita Burke and Ruth Kovac. And on behalf of the city of Côte Saint-Luc, I'd like to present a framed copy of this to Mr. Elbaz. Monsieur Elbaz était le président depuis 2017. Au cours de sa fructueuse carrière dans le monde d'éducation, il a assumé plusieurs fonctions importantes, enseignant, directeur, adjoint, coordinateur des études français, directeur des études français et représentant des études des écoles, JPPS Bialik, auprès du ministère de l'Éducation du Québec. Il a été aussi conseiller pédagogique auprès de l'Association des écoles juives de Montréal et délégué auprès des écoles juives montréalaises de l'Alliance israélite universelle, une prestigieuse institution éducative aux ramifications internationales. In 2012, Mr. Elbaz was honored by the government of France as an officer of the Ordre des Arts de Lettres. Please welcome Mr. Elbaz.
Thank you.
you're part of that picture, and Mr. Archibald as well. That would be great. We'll take a quick picture. Okay, so now I'm going to ask David Berenbaum, I'd like to say a few words, and then Anthony Housefather.
Bonjour tout le monde. Monsieur le Président Abbas, chers collègues, Anthony Housefather, Monsieur le Maire, Jim Archibald, past president. Ça me fait honneur aussi de me joindre à vous et de me permettre de féliciter le Spanish and Portuguese au nom du Premier ministre Philippe Couillard. 250 years is not a passing fancy. That's quite a record, and it's nice to hear the very complete and thoughtful resolution offered by the city of Côte Saint-Luc, because it provides us with a capsule of a community, an organization that has en quelque part à tracer les racines de notre communauté juive au Canada, pour ne pas dire juste le Montréal, et ce trame de fond qui a été toujours le Spanish and Portuguese, and the example, I think, in many ways, it has set over the years in bringing the diverse elements of our own Jewish community together in passing a message that I hope and I think our institutions across the community have done over the years, which is to say that our community is also our community, Quebec and Canada as well, et qu'on tisse nos liens pas juste entre nous, comme le peuple juif, avec ses liens avec les diasporas partout au monde et avec notre cher Israël, mais nous sommes chez nous ici au Québec, à Montréal, Canada. And my understanding of the Spanish is that it has always set that example of vivre ensemble, and that's certainly a wonderful occasion to celebrate. So it's nice to see this year being celebrated in so many wonderful and joyous ways, through music, through scholarly reminders of what the congregation has meant, and tonight is one more opportunity, and I'm very pleased to be here and to join you in celebrating. Thank you, merci.
Monsieur le Président Edmond Abbas, past President Jim Archibald, Mayor Mitchell Brownstein, Councillor Dieter Berku, and my colleague David Birnbaum, member of the National Assembly for Darcy McGee, and you guys, Côte Saint-Luc residents, members of Spanish and Portuguese, and others who are interested. Earlier this year, I had the opportunity to rise in the House of Commons to congratulate the Spanish and Portuguese congregation, Shearith Israël, on its 250th anniversary. And that was a moment that was of great pride to me, as it always is when I get to talk about the Canadian Jewish community in the House of Commons. Whether it's confronting BDS, whether it's standing up to Iran, or whether it's talking about a synagogue, a venerable synagogue in my riding that is now 250 years old, it's wonderful to be able to remind my fellow Canadians across the country, and in particular the non-Jewish community, of the lasting impact that the Jewish community has made to Canada for the last 250 years. And the Spanish and Portuguese congregation has been at the forefront of bringing together Jewish Canadians of all stripes. Even from the time that I was born in the 1970s, this congregation has changed enormously. There's 4 or 5 minions that go on at the Spanish, and as opposed to the majority Ashkenazic congregation that existed when I was a little kid and Rabbi Joseph was the rabbi, today you have a majority congregation that comes from countries like Iraq and Egypt and Lebanon and Morocco. Nous avons des gens, des racines de partout dans le monde qui viennent au Spanish et qui se sent chez eux. And it's great to have that because this congregation has provided Montreal and Canada with people who have done incredible things. How many of you know that the first Jewish chief of police of Montreal, Moses Hayes, was a member of this congregation? Between 1850 and 1853, he was the chief of police. That David was the founder of the Montreal Water Company and was one of the founding directors of the Bank of Montreal. He was a member of this congregation. Rabbi DeSola, professor at McGill, one of the renowned historians of Canada in the 19th centuries, from this congregation. So, with the incredible leaders we have today, de toutes les différentes communautés qui se composent de la communauté juive, et les gens qui ont été là pour deux siècles et demi. C'est un grand atout pour le Canada que nous avons le Spanish. And I look forward to hearing from Jim today, even though he's not wearing his top hat and his morning coat, all about the history of this venerable congregation. But thank you so much for what you guys have given Montreal, Quebec, and Canada.
Bonsoir à tous. Thank you for joining us. What a year we had. I can't believe it. We had a gala, we had a concert last week, and we keep having one joyful event after another. So much so that I told Sandy before, I don't know anymore if I could keep the pace of all these events. And I told a friend before, I can't wait for the 251 year to move on. Monsieur le maire, mes chers amis, Monsieur Bronstein, Monsieur Anthony Hausfaller, député fédéral du comté de Mont-Royal, David Birnbaum, député provincial pour le comté de Narcy-Mangui, et chers conseillers, Madame Janine West, directrice de la bibliothèque, je vous suis très reconnaissant de nous accueillir pour notre exposition historique dans cette enceinte de l'hôtel de ville de Côte-Saint-Luc, pour célébrer ensemble le 250e anniversaire de la Spanish and Portuguese, la plus ancienne synagogue au Canada. Cet anniversaire, rappelons-le, marque la naissance de la communauté juive de Montréal en 1768, de son essor et contribution remarquable à travers notre ville, notre province et le reste du Canada. Ce qui fait de nous tous ici ce soir des héritiers d'une glorieuse histoire qui s'étend sur deux siècles et demi. Nos pensées et hommages vont aux pionniers et visionnaires de notre peuple qui ont fondé Shearith Israël, qui veut dire en hébreu les rescapés du peuple juif. Il s'agit en effet, rappelons-le, de ceux et celles qui ont accueilli les nombreux exilés d'Europe au début du XXe siècle et plus tard, les déshérités des pays du Machrek et du Maghreb, du Moyen-Orient et de bien d'autres contrées lointaines. Loin de leur pays d'origine, ces coreligionnaires arrachés à leur terre ancestrale ont trouvé au Québec et dans notre congrégation un foyer accueillant et chaleureux. Ils ont à leur tour bâti notre cité, enrichi notre province et notre pays par leur labeur, leur savoir, leur vision et ingéniosité, une réalité peu connue de l'histoire des Juifs du Québec, dont voici quelques exemples. Anthony en a déjà mentionné quelques-uns. Aaron Hart, bien sûr, que l'on considère comme étant le père fondateur de la communauté juive du Canada, s'installe à Trois-Rivières en 1761, où il ouvre un commerce de fourrures. Son fils Ézéchiel est le premier juif élu à la Chambre de l'Assemblée du Bas-Canada. Parmi les neveux d'Aaron Hart, écoutez bien, c'est intéressant. Nous trouvons les quatre frères Joseph. Tous se sont distingués par leur esprit d'entreprise et leur sens civique. Abraham Joseph, par exemple, se présente aux élections municipales de Québec. Rien moins que ça. Jesse Joseph, son frère, est président de la Montreal Gas Company, qui devient bien plus tard Hydro-Québec. Donc Hydro-Québec a été créé au tout début par un juif qui s'appelle Jesse Joseph. Le même Jesse Joseph est le père de la Montreal Street Railway, qui devint la société de transport de Montréal. Donc, les autobus et les métros qu'on prenait tous les jours, au départ, c'était Jesse Joseph qui en a conçu les premiers éléments. Une autre famille fondatrice de la synagogue espagnole et portugaise est celle de Lazarus David, dont le fils David David fut l'un des fondateurs de la Banque de Montréal, Anthony l'a mentionné tout à l'heure, et membre fondateur de l'organisme qui devient la Chambre de commerce de Montréal. Et ainsi de suite pour d'autres familles fondatrices, les Benjamin, Jacobs, Judas, Salomon et Hess, pour ne nommer que celles-là. Aujourd'hui, nous avons le mérite de voguer sur les ailes de ces pionniers, car ils nous ont pavé le chemin sur lequel nous œuvrons tous les jours. Chaque pan de l'histoire canadienne porte en elle la signature de ces premières familles juives séfarades, descendants des juifs rescapés de l'Inquisition espagnole, originaires d'Angleterre et des colonies américaines, établies sur les bords du Saint-Laurent au début des années 1760. Ces pionniers, tels que Simon Lévy, Aaron Hart, Joseph, Hayes et bien d'autres, avaient loué un espace, comme vous le savez, au coin de la rue Saint-Jacques en 1768, où 15 familles se réunissaient régulièrement pour prier. Cet espace, au coin de la rue Saint-Jacques et Notre-Dame, c'est là où se trouve aujourd'hui le palais de justice. Et ce terrain appartenait à la famille David, qui l'a cédé plus tard à la ville. Donc, ces pionniers nous ont pavé la voie, et ils ont pavé la voie à tous ceux qui les ont suivis après, à tous les Juifs qui se trouvent aujourd'hui au Canada et qui ont contribué par leur savoir, par leur science, par leur énergie, au progrès de tout ce qui se fait aujourd'hui au Québec. J'ai à présent l'immense honneur de vous présenter mon ami, Dr Jim Archibald, président sortant de notre synagogue, qui va nous entretenir d'un sujet à l'engagement social de notre congrégation. Dr Jim Archibald est directeur du département de linguistique et traduction à l'Université McGill. Titulaire d'un doctorat de l'Université de Lille, M. James Archibald enseigne la traduction à l'Université McGill. Parmi ses dernières publications figurent « Pour l'engagement sociétal du traducteur », circuit 131-2016, « Translating Politically Sensitive Text in Multilingual Context », Cambridge Scholars Publishing 2016, « Managing Translation Quality Multilingual Sitting » en 2017, et la traduction en dacalogue de la Charte montréalaise des droits et responsabilités 2017, qui a eu énormément de succès et dont la copie se trouve aujourd'hui à l'hôtel de ville. Jim, pour les intimes, a dirigé l'édition française des numéros 87, 88, 90 et 91 de la revue internationale Higher Education, publié conjointement par Boston College et l'Agence Université de la Francophonie en 2017-2018. Il était professeur invité au Centre de langue et traduction de l'Université libanaise. Chevalier dans l'Ordre des Palmes académiques, M. Archibald est membre du Conseil supérieur de la langue française et de l'Office des professeurs du Québec, ainsi qu'expert de l'Organisation internationale de la normalisation. Enfin, je tiens en terminant dire bien sûr un grand merci à tout le monde, à tous les bénévoles ce soir qui ont fait un travail remarquable en présentant cette exposition que vous allez voir tantôt. Merci à tous et très bonne soirée.
Merci beaucoup, Benoît. Nous allons débuter notre soirée par la projection d'un court métrage sur l'histoire de la Spanish. Et par la suite, j'aurai l'occasion de vous entretenir un petit peu, c'est-à-dire de revenir sur les petites bribes d'histoire que vous avez déjà entendues. Et donc, sans plus tarder, on va passer à la projection de ce petit court-métrage.
L'histoire de notre congrégation, la plus ancienne au Canada, s'inscrit dans celle de la naissance de notre communauté juive en 1760.
It's very important for people to know that organized Judaism would probably not be the way it is today if not for the Spanish and Portuguese.
It's important that my children find their place here and show their families the way to practice a wonderful Jewish life in a very modern environment, which is what the synagogue offers.
Wherever you're from, we welcome that history.
Congregation always had a very noble sense of itself.
La première synagogue était sur la rue Saint-Jacques, puis ensuite c'est passé à la rue Geneville.
When the community was moving further away from there and more towards downtown, we established a congregation on Stanley Street.
Et de la rue Stanley, on est venu ici. Ce bâtiment est là depuis 1954.
It's really incredible that the synagogue had been this integrative place where people could find themselves and be themselves within the umbrella that was given to them by the synagogue.
It refreshed itself by accepting the new members and looking for immigrants all coming in.
People, they want to go to a rabbi or to a cantor that was involved with them, with the history of their families.
Ces rabbins étaient des monuments qui étaient très proches de la population.
Rabbi Frank was a very, very open, warm, and welcoming human being. His presence was felt. Then he was followed by Rabbi Joseph, and Rabbi Joseph was a young rabbi coming in, and this was very refreshing for the synagogue. And then we had Rabbi Ornstein. He was, again, extremely warm and inviting person who was always available.
The Moroccans start to take our synagogue seriously. They liked the prestige of our congregation and the fellowship and respect that everybody showed each other.
My family has been here since they immigrated to Canada. We were the first Iraqi family to come to the synagogue, and I just want to live the legacy of the synagogue.
On continue dans la tradition que les premiers bâtisseurs ont déterminée pour cette synagogue, et d'être impliqué dans l'histoire de la synagogue, pour moi, est un grand privilège.
People have associated us with a community as opposed to just members of the synagogue.
One of the things that keeps us together as Jews is we have this tremendous shared sense of history going back way more than 250 years.
There's a beauty to the synagogue in the fact that it has so many different cultures that make up what it is.
This idea of people respecting each other is the foundation of any good society.
Pour nous, vivre 250 ans, célébrer 250 ans d'histoire, c'est quelque chose qui est absolument magnifique et grandiose.
I hope they'll continue this openness. It'll be the foundation for future growth.
I want to set an example for my family and for other young people and other young families to come here, because the synagogue is a wonderful place to be.
What I realize is, you know, I always came to the synagogue. I took it for granted that It exists, it's running. All of a sudden, I became an adult and I realized that I need to do something about it too.
I would like the young adults to be more involved. This is a synagogue of their fathers, their forefathers, and we're hoping that it will be their synagogue as well in the future.
Je suis un juif espagnol. Je suis un grec arménien. Je suis un français créole qui devient un étranger parisien. Je suis un juif espagnol. Je suis un grec arménien. Je suis partout où les hommes ont besoin de parler à quelqu'un.
Now back to do what I do is for winning. Monsieur le maire, messieurs les députés, I won't distinguish between the two governments. Madame la conseillère, I was given very strict instructions tonight. Don't talk too long. Don't tell too many stories, and speak in English. So, I had a great debate with myself, because what do I do? And the Spanish have to decide, do we speak in French, do we speak in English, do we speak in Arabic, or sometimes in Spanish, etc. So I decided I'm going to primarily use English, but I'll use the others from time to time. So, the theme of the talk that I wanted to present tonight goes a little bit outside, goes a little bit outside the actual history of the Spanish and Portuguese per se. Because I think it's important to put that history into a context, to know where we came from, why we came here, and what we're doing, and what the future orientation is. And Monsieur le député, you'll excuse me if I give a slight political twist to this as well. So, the theme that I want to deal with tonight is not, as was said before, social engagement, but more over societal engagement. There's a difference. Societal means that people are involved in building a society. People are involved in building all of the infrastructure that a society needs in order to function, whether it be the gas company, the electricity company, the transportation, etc. And all of those things which are important to build a vibrant living society. Okay? So that essentially is the perspective that I want to share with you tonight. The Spanish and Portuguese synagogue in Montreal is not alone in the world, as you've been able to guess from what's been said before, but it is part of a worldwide network of Spanish and Portuguese congregations throughout the world. And one has to understand how that network came into being historically, why it's there, and what does it mean in terms of what we refer to as societal engagement. Because if we go back to, in fact, in some of the examples that I'll give you, to the 15th century, when there was major change going on in the Spanish peninsula, Jews were very much part of Spanish society at that point in time. They contributed to the intellectual life, to the economic life. They provided services for all subjects under the then queen. Things changed in 1492, obviously, and history will show us what happened. But these communities, as is true of Shearith, Israël, here in Montreal, are an example of the commitment of Jews to Torah first, to education, to the community. And these are very important when you're engaged in community building and in the process of transmitting a culture from one generation to the next. If you don't have Torah, you don't have education, and you don't have a sense of communal belonging, you're basically, as we say in colloquial English, up a creek without a paddle. So I'd like to look at this from a historical perspective, and then share with you a few actual examples of individuals who have provided this type of support for community growth and community development. So in terms of the backdrop that we should be aware of, there is, if you look at the history of Sfaradim in the world, there is a tradition of societal, social, and intellectual engagement. These were not Jews who sat on the sidelines. These were Jews who were involved in society from every perspective. And so, after the expulsion from Spain, the remnants of the Jews of Spain, which is the actual meaning of Shearith Israël, because Shearith means the remainder, the remnants, what is left, etc. They went on to establish very thriving Jewish communities in other European countries. Some will even argue that that started at the beginning of the discovery of the Americas as well. It's not entirely proven yet. But the point is that these Jews left, they went to England, they went to the Netherlands, they went to Italy, they went to France, they went to Belgium, etc. And they all established in these different countries very viable, vibrant communities which were engaged and which were active from a social point of view, from an intellectual point of view, and from an economic point of view. Just to give you an example of the intellectual life that followed in the 17th and 18th centuries, if we're looking at a similar period in time for the foundation of the Spanish here in Montreal, you had Ladino-speaking, Spanish-speaking Jews in London who continued to maintain the language, and who continued to do intellectual work in that language and who published in that language. And what's interesting is that, for instance, you have the vocabulary of Hebrew and Mishnaic terms, which was published in London in Spanish during that period. Another one, published in Spanish at that time in London, was a book of the Psalms, translated into Ladino. And in Venice, which was also a center for Sephardi life after the expulsion, there was also a center for publication as well. It's interesting, in our library at home, we have a book which was in fact printed in Hebrew and Ladino, which was edited in Venice and which came to our house via Baghdad. It's interesting how those things work out. And finally, the other community that I would mention is a community in Bayonne. Bayonne received many Jews who fled Spain, etc., established a community there, and it also was a center for intellectual life. And interestingly enough, one of the publications which came out of the community in Bayonne was called La Via de Salvación, the way of salvation, etc. And so that spirit, in fact, was very much alive. When the situation in Europe developed to the point where Jews started to feel uncomfortable, they needed to have greater freedoms, freedom of the press, freedom of religion, etc. There was a westward expansion of the Sephardi communities toward some of the major trading ports on the eastern seaboard and in the Caribbean. And so the first communities to be established in that side of the world, if you will, were in Newport, in New Amsterdam, which is now New York, in Philadelphia, and later on at that same time in Montreal. Those dates are very close. And so there was a sense of international community within the Sephardi community at that point in time. The example that I'd like to give to you, which has not a direct link with Montreal, but is interesting to look at from that point of view, is the community in Newport. Newport is a small port city in Rhode Island, and it was basically established by Jews who were Spanish-speaking and Portuguese-speaking, who came there in order to seek out a new life with opportunities. Remind you of immigrants going most anywhere, right? But it was a very interesting community historically because they were involved in very key areas of socioeconomic development. They were merchants, they were shippers, and they were also involved in the intellectual life of that. You can trace, in fact, the foundation of Yale University back to members of the Sephardi community in Newport. We're not slackers. So, as my former brother-in-law pointed out in one of his works, and I quote him, said, the intellectual climate of the time was remarkable for tolerance, sympathy, and enlightened interest. Those words are important, I think, when you're looking at the way these communities developed, because they came looking for tolerance, they came looking for openness, they came looking for a sympathetic relationship, almost in the French sense of the word sympathique, with regard to the host communities. And they were looking for interest in relationships, which was, as Haiti put it, enlightened interest. Because at this point in time, all of these people were under the influence of the Enlightenment, which I will come back to briefly at the end. So, if we look then historically at how this network grew, and look at it in terms of a timeline, the synagogue in Amsterdam, if we look at the 17th century, was initially organized in 1610 and finally reorganized in 1675. That's about 100 years before the time we're talking about here. Shortly after that, in 1654, Shearith Israël in New York was established because of the connection between Amsterdam and New York. In 1657, only 3 years later, the Spanish and Portuguese community in London organized itself and saw the emergence of two major communities which are still in existence today, Bevis Marks and Lauderdale Road. Many of you have relatives who go to both of those synagogues. Bevis Marks has a bit of a problem now because the area has changed and it's difficult to get a minyan, but it's still there. Moving closer to the date of Montreal, in 1763, the Touro Synagogue in Newport was opened. And only 5 years later, Shearith Israël was opened in Montreal. And I'll point out a link between the two in a moment. A little bit later, in 1775, the Jews of Philadelphia also organized and established a community there under the name of Migve Israël. And later on, if we move forward, even though Spanish and Portuguese Jews were present in Paris and in different cities in France, especially in Bordeaux and Bayonne, these communities were not organized in the same way. Because there was a traditional Ashkenazi community which was in power, if you will, and there was a bit of a power struggle. And so it's interesting to look at the history of, if we look at the history of the synagogue, Synagogue La Rochefoucauld in Paris, which is the main Sephardi synagogue in Paris of Spanish tradition, if you will. That synagogue came into being in 1875, much later. Why? Because there was a disagreement with the synagogue Rue de la Victoire. Rue de la Victoire was dominated by Ashkenazim, and the Sephardim decided, okay, enough is enough. We're going to set up our own shop, and so Rue de Buffon was built in, and opened in 1875. The same thing happened in Bordeaux with that type of relationship. In Bordeaux, the Grand Synagogue in Bordeaux was opened in 1882, and the synagogue in Bayonne, the Synagogue de la Rue Maubec, was opened in 1836. So that sort of shows you how this evolves over a period of time. And the creation of the synagogue in Montreal fits very much within that historical perspective. So if I go back to Newport. Newport is a fascinating example because it's small, it's easy to study. In 1658, 15 Spanish Portuguese families arrived in Newport. And as in Montreal, they met in homes, they had religious services. And interestingly enough, even though they were small in numbers, they were observant. They ate kasher, they observed Shabbat, they observed holidays, even though they were small in numbers. And they existed that way for about 100 years. And it was only in 1758 that a decision was made by the community elders to actually build a building. And so 5 years later, in 1763, the Touro Synagogue was inaugurated under the leadership of Isaac de Abraham Touro. And the only record of the event, interestingly enough, for those who were archivists, is to be found in a newspaper published at that period in time in Newport called the Newport Mercury. And allow me to read you an excerpt from the article which was published in the Newport Mercury. I quote, "Think about this when you think about inaugurating a synagogue at any place, any point in time in history. Let your imagination run. In the afternoon was the dedication of the new synagogue in this town. It began by a handsome procession in which were carried the books of the law to be deposited in the ark. Several portions of scripture and their service with a prayer for the royal family were read and finally sung by the priest and people." It's obviously written by a non-Jew. "There were present many gentlemen and ladies." Gentlemen and ladies. "The order of decorum, the harmony, and the solemnity of the music, together with the handsome assembly of people in an edifice the most perfect of the temple kind, perhaps in America, and splendidly illuminated, could not but raise in the mind a faint idea of the majesty and grandeur of the ancient Jewish worship mentioned in the scriptures." End quote. What is interesting is, obviously, this was before the revolution, and so this was still under King George. And I didn't name our first son George because of King George, by the way. But they said the prayer for the royal family. And if you've attended the Spanish, because we're still part of the Commonwealth, despite what some people in Quebec say, we say a prayer, which I have the opportunity to say every Shabbat, and we bless Queen Elizabeth II and all the members of the royal family, in addition to blessing the Lieutenant Gouverneur du Québec. But this description dating back to 1763 is very interesting to read, because it shows that really we haven't changed that much. We do the same things, we have the same values, and seen from the outside by the non-Jew who wrote this particular text, the people there were respectful of decorum, they lived in harmony, they had a solemn service, they were respectful for the government in place, for the monarchy, etc. It was a description almost of a perfect world. And so, who were these ladies and gentlemen in Newport? Compare that to the little bits that you heard at the beginning in the introduction with Anthony and with Edmond. These people were business people. They were engaged in international trade. There was no internet then. There was no cell phone. There was nothing, right? They had sailing ships in a harbor, and it rained out most of the time. So these people were business people engaged in international trade with language and intercultural skills that set them apart from the people like the man who wrote the article in the Mercury. Because by virtue of the fact that they were different, living in a host society which was different, had a different set of beliefs, they had to master that type of relationship, being able to deal with the other. And who better than Jews to be able to deal with the other, right? And on top of it, in terms of language, most of the people in this community, because of the fact that they had transmitted their traditions since their immigration, they spoke Spanish, Portuguese, Dutch, yes, Dutch, because many came via Amsterdam, and English, which was their new language. And so they were able to engage in international trade much more easily than the unicultural, unilingual American colonists who were there before. So what were they involved in? What were their business activities? What did they do? They were involved in banking. They were involved in, think of the economy in the time, they were involved in candle manufacture, using whale oil. Don't forget, Newport was a whaling port, and that was big business in those days. So they didn't have to worry about pipelines and arguing with the different governments about whether you build a pipeline or not. They just wanted to kill the few whales, and they made the oil, and that was it. That's fine, they made the candles. They were involved in foundries, brass and iron. They were involved in tenez-vous bien. They were involved in exporting kosher food products. Newport was a center for kashrut. And where did they export their food goods? They exported them to other communities in the Caribbean, because there are other Spanish and Portuguese communities in the Caribbean. They exported them also to other American communities, especially New York. Like, New York doesn't have enough kosher food. They also were involved in the manufacture of soap, the potash trade. They were obviously big shippers. They owned shipping fleets. They were involved in silver, and they were involved in what was the oil industry at that particular point in time, which was whale oil. So you can see similarities with the types of economic activities that these people were involved in with regard to the economic activities in which the early founders of the Spanish Portuguese in Montreal were involved in. Now, there were no whales in the Montreal port, but still. So, when the synagogue was finally opened, and this is a political side of the story, is that these people were subjects of the king. Then there was an American Revolution, and all of a sudden they became citizens of the new republic. Sounds familiar, right? So, who was invited, in fact, shortly after the establishment of the American Republic at that point in time? George Washington was invited to visit the synagogue in Newport. And why was George Washington invited at this point in time? Because one of the reasons he was invited was that he was proposing amendments to the Constitution. They just had a revolution, they had a new constitution, and you wanted to amend it already. So one of the amendments that he wanted was to guarantee the freedom of religion and to guarantee the freedom of the press, which are essential items for any democracy. And as you sit in Quebec City, you know that freedom of the press is a very important point in our current political debate. So the then president of the congregation in Newport wrote a letter to George Washington thanking him for coming to basically promote his agenda. That's what political people do sometimes. And so he wrote this letter in August of 1790. I'm only going to read you an excerpt from the letter. And I quote, this is Moses Cessas. Deprived as we were heretofore, have been made of invaluable rights of free citizens. We now, with a deep sense of gratitude to the Almighty, O Hashem, disposer of all events, behold a government elected by the majesty of the people, a government which to no bigotry, gives no sanction, to persecution no assistance, but generously affording to all liberty of conscience and immunities of citizenship, deeming everyone of whatever nation, tongue, or language equal parts of the great governmental machine. You can quote that in the National Assembly next time. So, and of course, interestingly enough, George Washington was accompanied by the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and he also was accompanied by Thomas Jefferson, who had been able to communicate the ideas of the Enlightenment to George Washington in that context. George Washington was not insensitive to this, and so he wrote back to Moses very quickly, in the same month of August. And let me read you an excerpt from George Washington's letter. And I'm reading this as Cessas' letter and Washington's letter, especially for politicians. And I quote George Washington, all citizens alike possess liberty of conscience and immunities of citizenship. It is now no more that toleration is spoken of as if it were the indulgence of one class of people, that another enjoyed the exercise of their inherent natural rights. For, happily, the government of the United States, which gives to bigotry no sanction, to persecution no assistance, requires only that they who live under its protection should demean themselves as good citizens in giving it on all occasions their effectual support. In closing, he added, may the children of the stock of Abraham who dwell in this land continue to merit and enjoy the goodwill of the other inhabitants, while every one shall sit in safety under his own vine and fig tree, and there shall be none to make him afraid. End of quote. The image of the fig tree is important because it's borrowed from the knowledge of the Bible and the knowledge of Eastern culture as was communicated through many of the scholars of the Enlightenment. And so George Washington was perfectly aware of that. The fig tree actually is a poor translation of the sycamore. The sycamore which provided fruit and which provided protection. For those Egyptians among you, if you've ever read Henri Chédid has a beautiful passage where he talks about the protection of the sycamore. And so this was the image that was done. So this was back in August of 1790, shortly after the American Revolution. And interestingly enough, every year in the month of August, in the city of Newport, this letter by George Washington is read on the anniversary of his visit to the United States' oldest synagogue. And it is read in order to celebrate the New Republic's commitment to the freedom of religion. So if I picked Newport as an example, I picked it because it was seen as the oldest synagogue in the United States, as we are seen as the oldest synagogue in Canada. And I think that, as we will see in a moment or two, we've also defended the same rights, and our members have defended the same rights. So if we looked at the ladies and gentlemen of Newport. Now the ladies and gentlemen of Montreal also were involved in very similar activities. You heard some examples before, so I won't belabor the issue. They were involved in food distribution, they were involved in the Board of Trade, they were involved in banking, they were involved in shipping, they were involved in the fur trade, they were involved in public utilities, they were involved in philanthropy and community service, they were lawyers, doctors, academics, civil servants. All of this in a very small community. But where the ethos was that they had to participate and they had to contribute. And therefore, they had to be actively involved in the development of that society. The other link with the early American communities in Newport and Philadelphia and New York is that the very first spiritual leader of the Montreal congregation was Jacob Raphael Cohen, who came from the Philadelphia community, Mikveh Israel, which I've mentioned to you before, which is a sister community of today's Spanish and Portuguese here in Montreal. So the concept, I use the expression the ladies and gentlemen of Newport and the ladies and gentlemen of Montreal. I use that expression specifically, and those of you who come from the Middle East will understand this, because in fact under the Ottoman Empire, one of the titles of deference that you use for a gentleman was Efendi, borrowed from Turkish. And in those societies, they developed a class of individuals, which in both Turkish and Arabic are referred to Efendiya. And so these people who were involved, in fact, even though they didn't use that term, they were in fact the Efendiya of those communities. They were the people who were invested with a certain level of respect, a certain level of responsibility for community growth and community development. And that, I think, is an extremely important thing to bear in mind. So if I look then at the Efendiya of Montreal, and if I look at the ladies and gentlemen of Montreal in more recent times, I think of a few examples, and I'm only going to, I know time is limited, and you're going to tell me to stop soon, probably. But I'm going to use three examples quickly to show that I'm almost like the Quebec government. I want to give equal play to both men and women. I want to mention, first of all, the Wolf Sisters. I don't know if you know the Wolf Sisters. But the Wolf Sisters are Annette, Esther, and Rosetta. they together are a powerhouse. What's left of them now is a powerhouse. They were historians, community volunteers, they were community activists, and they were proud descendants of Aaron Hart and Abraham Joseph. So there's a historic link between them and the beginning of this community in the early parts of the colony. What were they involved in when you compare that, their work, to the Effendia in Newport? Very involved with Command Jewish Appeal, the Comité du Fait Français, Comité des Relations Ashkenaz-Séfarades du Congrès Juif Canadien, you remember that? Fédération des Femmes du Québec, the Order of Nurses, the National Council of Jewish Women, and the Sisterhood of the Spanish and Portuguese Corporation. In fact, Esther Blaustein was the president of the Sisterhood. May she rest in peace. I think of Esther in particular because every Shabbat I look at the coat of arms which hangs in front of the pulpit, in front of the echal in the main sanctuary, and that was actually embroidered by Esther Blaustein, a descendant of Aaron Hart and Abraham Joseph. So that is a piece of history which is alive. They were devoted to the preservation of Jewish heritage. They were sticklers for decorum, especially when we had a new wave of immigration from North Africa. Esther was sometimes horrified by the fact that they weren't quiet enough, that children were allowed to run around, people talked, etc. But she got used to it after a while. And the Wolf family collection is something which archivists should jump on. And unfortunately, it hasn't been exploited enough. But it contains several boxes of important early Quebec documents. And these documents were donated to the archive in 2007 by Annette and her sister Rosetta. The other person I'd like to highlight, now that we've given deference to the ladies, is a gentleman who probably you won't find in too many history books. But to me, he was a very important person. And David, you probably may remember him as well. And I speak of the man whom we refer to in Hebrew as Meir ben Gershon HaLevi. He always got the Aliyah for Levi. Meir Levi was an immigrant to Canada, Quebec, from Egypt. He grew up in Alexandria. And if you know the history of consular Egypt, he really was French on one side, Italian on another side, but he identified with the Jewish community. And he identified himself as un juif d'Égypte, pas un juif égyptien. There's a difference. Gabby can explain that to you later. So, Meyer, with whom I worked very closely, drafted briefs on public issues of concern to the Jewish community and reviewed the press on a regular basis in order to identify stereotypes and examples of anti-Semitic or xenophobic discourse in the French language media, in order to bring these issues to the attention of community leaders and even to the Conseil de Presse. He wasn't bashful. His constant concern was the treatment of his fellow Jews and their host society, and their ability to exercise their full measure of rights in dignity. So the legal concept of dignity, Meyer was trained as a lawyer in Egypt. So the legal concept of dignity was at the core of his value system. And he felt that in this country where we have rights, it is extremely important to make sure that all citizens are treated with dignity. and that all citizens are able to exercise the full measure of their rights. And this was a driving force behind what he did. As a quick aside, one of the first briefs that actually we worked on together was a brief on the loi du cinéma. Quebec decided to adopt a law regulating cinema. And the first question I asked Meyer, I said, Meyer, why are we writing a brief on this? What's this got to do with Jews? He says, it has everything to do with Jews. Because it has to do with the freedom of the press, it has to do with dignity, it has to do with access to the media. And that's our job. And so if we can inform the government on an issue which isn't exactly a Jewish issue, that's our job. That's what we're supposed to do. Keep them honest. So Meyer was the Director of Community Relations for Canadian Jewish Congress between 65 and 84. He was a member of the group that founded the Cercle Juif de Langue Française, along with another one of our members, Naïm Caton. And I'll spare you my 3-hour lecture on Naïm Caton. He was a member of the Quebec Immigration Advisory Council. He was a member of the Groupe du Travail de la Communauté Juive au Conseil Supérieur de l'Éducation. And at the end of his life, he was a judge on the Human Rights Commission. Quite a character from that point of view. So when he was appointed to that position, Jacques Couture, who was the minister at that particular point in time, noted that he made this appointment, and I'm quoting Couture, for the benefit of all Quebecers, end quote. In other words, these people who were involved in society weren't involved only to promote the Jewish agenda, sure, but as recognized by governmental authority, they were also doing this work for the benefit of all Quebecers, everybody, without exception. And so as a member of the Comité des Affaires Interconfessionnelles et Interculturelles at the Conseil Supérieur de l'Éducation, Meyer helped to draft the Jewish community position concerning access to public education, which is another major issue, to go back to what I said before. Torah, education, service to the community. And this led to the publication by the Conseil of a controversial report entitled L'école et les enfants de divers groupes ethniques et religieux. And this is back in 1979. So Meyer proposed in that brief, of course with the agreement of all of the volunteers and other people who were involved, etc. But he was the one who penned it to start with. He proposed that Jewish students be exempted from religious education in the public system. And that, and I quote in French from his text, tout programme de formation morale et religieuse d'inspiration juive soit dispensé par des enseignants qui ont un haut degré d'engagement et de compétence dans cette matière et qui sont dûment accrédités. Which means that he expected the Quebec government to turn around to the Jewish community and say, which one of these people has been actually recognized as being competent to teach this subject matter in the Jewish schools? And so as a result of that intervention, the Conseil recommended, and I quote, that des programmes de formation morale et religieuse pour les enfants de foi juive soient élaborés en consultation avec les communautés intéressées. So it wouldn't be imposed by anyone sitting in Quebec City, but it would be agreed upon following consultation with the community. And so that's another example of how that group of people was involved. My final example, you can rest in peace now. The final example is my dear friend and colleague, Laura Shalom, Alan Rose. Alan is what I call societal engagement personified. If you want to look for a model, Alan was the model. who is a grandson of Yahya Gubay of Baghdad, and he emigrated, his grandfather emigrated to Calcutta, like many Iraqi business families at that point in the 19th century. Alan was born in Great Britain and emigrated to Canada in 1957, where he distinguished himself as a great public servant of the Jewish people, and also a great public servant for all people, because he also was imbued with that sense of right and dignity and access to freedom. He was a decorated liberator of Bergen-Belsen, and later in life, he worked to improve the lives of his fellow Jews in the Soviet Union, Ethiopia, and Cuba. We organized together shipments of food every year for our brethren in Cuba. And in his relations with the government in Canada, he worked behind the scenes to organize the reunification of many Iraqi Jewish families, thus enabling some 700 relatives in Baghdad to obtain Iraqi exit visas and Canadian entry visas. Ce n'est pas rien. He was known for his integrity, for his decency, for his honor, for his credibility. Alan said he would do something, he did it. He said, you got to go talk to the minister about this, he did it. And he had access. That was the important part. He was a committed interculturalist, a bit like the ladies and gentlemen of Newport. He had those skills. And he worked incessantly to establish a viable working relationship with citizens of all faiths. He worked very well with the Catholic community, the Protestant community, with the Islamic community, etc., because of the fact that he simply had it in his DNA. So he has been recognized by many for his contributions to the Jewish Agency, to Canadian Jewish Congress, the Immigration and Refugee Board, and he received the U.S. Presidential Citation of Honor. He was a member of the Order of Canada. He received the Médaille Militaire de la Libération de France. He received the Samuel Bronfman Medal. And he received the Jerusalem Prize from the World Zionist Organization. So the Spanish is proud to count him and his widow Joyce, who's an accomplished artist in her own right, among its most illustrious members. So those are just a few examples of people who have distinguished themselves through their societal involvement and our relationship, very close relationship with our community. So, in conclusion, to paraphrase Rabbi Dr. Theodore Lewis' message to the Jews of Newport on the occasion of our sister synagogue's 250th anniversary, I chose that because of the 250. Rabbi Lewis said the following, and I quote, "You must determine to go from strength to strength in making positive commitments to the welfare and well-being of your congregation, and to determine that Montreal Jewry will add a proud chapter to the evolving history of Canadian Jewry." He obviously talked about Newport Jewry and American Jewry, but we can see the same message is there. And I think that is the ethos of our congregation. It has been the ethos of our congregation throughout history, that we are engaged in society, we contribute to society, and we are not bashful in any way, shape, or form when it comes to sharing our advice with those in power. Beware. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the library and the city of Côte Saint-Luc, we really want to thank you for that absolutely fascinating discussion. Thank you very much for coming. We have a few more moments if anybody has a couple of questions. I'm sure that Professor Archibald will be happy to answer. Is there any questions? Okay. Got what?
Egypt.
Thank you. That's one of my favorite questions. That's another hour. But the point is that if you look at different countries in Mashrek and Maghreb, many of these countries, the Jewish populations in those countries were indigenous populations. Indigenous as far as indigenous can be, for instance. So the Iraqi Jewish population can trace its history back to the destruction of the temple. On the other hand, Egypt is a, like a crossroads. And under what was called the consular system in Egypt, many members of the Jewish community, even though they were born in Egypt, did not have Egyptian nationality. So they depended on the Greek consulate, the Italian consulate, the French consulate, etc. And they had passports from those different countries, etc. So they were Jews who lived in Egypt, but they weren't really Egyptian Jews in the sense, there was, if you go back in history, there were a handful of Jews who were originally from Egypt, etc. Why do we talk about Yetziat Mitzrayim all the time? But the point is that, that system was very different in Egypt. And so therefore, you know, Iraqi Jews had Iraqi passports. They were subjects of the king until he died, he was assassinated. But the Egyptian Jews didn't have the same status. And so this was a situation which actually reflected the legal construct under the Ottoman Empire, where people had different levels of status within a society, etc. And so the Egyptian Jews, to use the expression in English, were really the Jews of Egypt, because they were the Jews who lived in Egypt, but who did not have claim to Egyptian citizenship. It's a brief explanation. Yeah, it changed when every Jew had to leave. Probably the people who are remaining in Egypt were not able to either dispose of their material goods or were not able to get passports in order to leave the country. So they may be stateless, in fact, and that's another major problem.
Thank you. I see another question out here.
The question is the correction. Because there are many Jews in Egypt that have Egyptian passports.
Yeah. There were some. But it was a very confused situation.
There are consulates, one, two, I know, in my family, but a lot of those that have Egyptian passports. Yeah.
Yes,
mine is not a question, it's a statement. About 25 years ago, we were in Newport, and they had an open house at the synagogue. Apparently, it's not a working synagogue today, but we were given a tour, and we were told that on Saturday, there was a bar mitzvah that was going to be taking place that Saturday, and if we would be in Newport, we were invited. And we went to the bar mitzvah, some strange day, I don't know where it was. All I know is you can rent it for weddings and bar mitzvahs. Yes. I'm very happy that you talked about it today.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a beautiful, beautiful building. And the archives are treasure trove.
It's unbelievable. Yeah. Very impressive.
Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you for coming. Sure, I'd like to invite you all into the library for dessert and coffee and to view the exhibit.